Great. Excellent. So we're actually we're on the live stream, apparently, and we'll start in a minute with some introductions. William, you have a very jazzy background. I like your background.
Well, it's a virtual background, but we actually printed it out.
Oh, excellent.
So
I love these virtual backgrounds. I guess you guys have seen some of the more crazy virtual backgrounds you can get. No, I'm happy to see we're not really using them. I mean, some people, Minecraft, I guess some of you have seen that as a background. It's quite funny.
Yeah, the craziest ones are the ones that are animated.
Oh, really? Oh,
boy. Creepy. Yeah, moving palm trees in the background.
Yes, yes, yes. That sounds a little bit too much. Of course, in Malta, you can just open the window and you'll see palm trees waving in the background, right?
Not as much as we used to, but yes.
Yeah, and Torsten can show us the Reichstag, so that's fantastic. Marvelous. Okay, guys, well, I reckon it's 7:15, so we're going to start. So we don't know who is with us at this point, but I wanted to say good morning, everyone, who may be joining this Horasis Global Meeting at this time. It's early for Europe. Much nicer for our Asian friends, so good afternoon to our Asian friends, much more comfortable. And a brave North American who happens to be up at this time of night. Michael Stopford, and I'm moderating this session, which is 45 minutes long. I'm the founding partner of a company called ANCORED. I have to spell it out for you, ANCORED, which is a data-based strategic communication company, which we launched out of Sweden. And we base our work in the online world of global social media. So we're acutely aware of the effects of this pandemic. Some of the largest organizations in the world, NATO, UN, World Bank, ExxonMobil, Coca-Cola, etc. And I know all of them are in one way or other feeling the impacts of this pandemic dramatically. And we will come to discuss these things in a second. So this panel is on pivoting your business. And I'm just reading out the title here. Business leaders have to come up with creative ideas to cope with a world in its lockdown crisis. To pivot, think outside the box, right? Take risks and experiment with new business models, if we possibly can. What are the opportunities and challenges of pivoting your business when the future is uncertain? And how can you plan for your company's future post-COVID? Well, we have some great speakers from around the world, from different sectors and from different regions. And so without more ado, I'm going to hand it over to them. They're going to briefly introduce themselves because you'll want to know who's there, who's speaking, what their business are, and then we'll get into the main subjects of the discussion. I think without having planned this in any kind of order of importance or whatever, but I think we're straight to Singapore now. And I'm going to begin with you, Yi, and we're delighted to have you with us today. So say hi to everyone.
Yeah, sure, Michael. Yeah, thank you, Phil. Yeah, I'm Yi, and I grew up in China. Went to Germany for study when I was 20. After the graduation, I started working for Deutsche Telekom Group. So within 16 years with Deutsche Telekom, I held different positions in different countries. The last position was in charge for the Asia-Pac region for Deutsche Telekom. In 2017, I founded MarvelTec with a few colleagues together. We took over the international wholesale business from Deutsche Telekom in the Asia region. So our business is to serve telecommunication providers and internet players in the region regarding their global network demand, but also to facilitate the operator partnerships, for example, on the IoT, in the IoT area. Currently, I'm living in Singapore with my family. So this is briefly about me and the business.
Oh, that's great. Great. Well, you have a really experienced background in telecom, Yi. That's wonderful. Related sectors, and we're delighted to have you with us from Singapore. I don't recall exactly the order, but I think Hassan, can you hear me, Hassan? Great. So Hassan, if it's okay with you, could you possibly introduce yourself next, if that's all right with you?
Absolutely. My name is Hassan, as you just stated. Before joining the Khyber Pakhtunkhwa government, which is a small province bordering Afghanistan, We have a population about 350 million, and it's growing with every second that we spend. And, a sizable consumer market. I am largely part of the investment attraction agency of the country as board of investment. And we seek, like any other investment agency, we seek investment from across the globe. And I'm also the focal person for the ease of doing business, the World Bank ease of doing business. Prior to joining the Board of Investment, I was the project director for one of the most important Belt and Road initiatives project called the China-Pakistan Corridor. So 4 years I was there as moving to and fro to China and looking at some long-term planning. And before that, I was a university professor. And prior to that, I was a diplomat serving in China, Vietnam, Bahrain, before retiring and joining the academia. But then again, the government called me back and put me as the project director. So it's been government all along, but now with investment.
Thank you very much, Hassan. That's fascinating. China, Pakistan, Afghanistan, you're at the meeting place of some extremely important and very timely activities in these key regions.
Happening place.
There you go. That's the word I was grasping for. Thank you very much. Excellent. Moving along. Torsten, shall we come to you and then we'll come to you, Morgan, and you, William, at the end? Torsten, joining us from Berlin.
That is right. And as you can see from my gray hair, I'm already a seasoned consultant, actually. Working as a managing partner at Gauly. We are a boutique helping our clients to develop business in China, in Asia, but also in other regions of the world, developing strategies, but also kind of helping them to convince governments and other entities to, kind of support them in realizing their strategies. So I've been working in China quite a time, in India, but also in the US for some time. So I hope I can bring something to the table from a German view, but with an international perspective.
Excellent. How interesting. I hadn't realized before that we have a lot of China focus here, so we may want to have some discussions about that. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much, Torsten. Morgan, can we come to you joining us from, is it Valletta or where in Malta? In Valletta?
At the moment, I'm in the north in a place called Dingley. It's a very beautiful place on the cliffs. It's morning, so I stayed at home first before going to the office.
Uh-huh.
So I'm Morgan. I'm an entrepreneur based in Malta. I have some various business interests which I'm involved in, some of which I can see with some of the attendees and people in the group in education, because I founded a business school which runs programs from diplomas to master's degrees. But I also have some interest in technology. So I'm a software company and market research business. So it's a bit spread. The interest part of it is based on my background when I was an executive growing up after graduating, where I worked in market research. But virtually I've also been setting up a number of businesses. So pretty much those are my business interests at the moment.
Thank you very much, Morgan. Thanks a lot. So, William, coming to you as you're joining us from Shanghai.
Yeah, great. Yeah. William Bean, general partner at SOSV. We're an early stage VC fund with $740 million under management. We're in the early stage in biotech, food tech and ag tech, and hardware, and I run internet and software. So what we do is help startups go cross-border, especially from around the world to Asia, into India, into Southeast Asia, into China. We also help companies from Asia go cross-border within Asia. So we're one of the partners for Khyber team problems with our China Accelerator, helping China, Pakistan work together. We're also the number five most active investor in India and the number nine most active investor in Southeast Asia. And as a fund, as of Q2, we're the most active VC in the world. We've already done 1,000 investments.
That's a very impressive and absolutely fascinating. So you have a broad view of, I suppose, really also how this crisis is affecting investments and opportunities. So this is great to have you with us. So gentlemen, and anybody else who is joining us this morning, we're going to ask some specific questions, but I think it would be fair to have one more round of everybody commenting now on the specific question of this panel, which is really, what has this COVID done to affect your business? And where are you making imaginative, if you like, innovative changes in your businesses to cope with it, if you are, if you're doing that? So let's go one more round again as we began and try and have a look at that. Is that okay for a question, everybody? And so Yi, can we begin with you again?
Sure, of course, yeah. So probably I would like to give a overall general view on the telecommunication industry instead of just a specific business.
Yeah.
I think with the COVID, of course, there's opportunity to increase the demand on connectivity, change of consumer behavior to online shopping, school, move to the online education. Also on the business side, like us now working from home and holding such virtual event, everything triggered higher demand on the connectivity side, which also means some positive effect for telecommunication providers. And I think also in a broader context, digital infrastructure now become the top priority for all the countries, and which means also, I do expect also increased investment in the telecommunication networks. For example, I think just the recent Next Generation Europe initiative, part of the agenda is also expanding and improving fiber network and also faster rollout 5G network. So this is one opportunity I definitely see for the telecom industry in general, but also part of our business. And then the second opportunity I do see is the accelerated penetration of Internet of Things technology. For example, in health area, a lot of new solutions now emerged to better and faster detect infection cases, but also to help healthcare personnel to better monitor patients remotely. Another example is in the manufacturing logistics area. I think the massive disruption of supply chain now requires also Internet of Things technology to faster and better distribute goods. So we are moving from actually just in time to just in case.
Uh-huh.
So, yeah. Now let me just quickly probably come also to the challenges side. The upside of connectivity business, as mentioned, is partially, I think, also offset by the decline of premium services. For example, international roaming service. Also, many impact companies and I think the expectation of a longer impact of COVID lead to higher cost pressure. Many companies also start to look how actually they can optimize their telecommunication spendings. We do see increased demand on the internet access from the company side. I think it leads to the assumption actually many companies have started or even accelerate their technology transformation from dedicated enterprise network to a more software-defined virtual networks. So
explain that last point again, from what to what?
From dedicated enterprise networks, so MPIS, usually the company, the enterprise, especially the bigger enterprise, they will buy actually dedicated telecommunication line, just assigned for them, now move to actually software-based. So basically they can actually use the normal internet broadband, just prioritize the different traffic, which actually for the telecom company means, of course, instead of premium service, they can sell a dedicated telecommunication line and now become more actually the lower level of service, just internet.
Uh-huh.
And the other probably both challenge opportunity is, I think telecom companies also now need to manage the network more resilient to accelerate actually the virtualization process of the network. So be able to manage network more remotely, centrally to reduce the dependency and on the on-site maintenance. This is actually the some, I think, challenges I see. The last point I'd like to mention is, I think for many telcos now is the question, how to keep in touch with customers? Because the main channel interacting with customer now are actually online and telephone. Just with auto menu and chatbots, it's very hard to provide the same level, the personalized customer experience. I think there's also opportunity here actually to launch much more and explore the AR and VR technology. Probably not try to copy the offline experience to online, but just to define and to create some refreshing, even more personalized, truly virtual experience there. So probably just a last comment. I think this mixed picture, both on the opportunity and trading side, is also being reflected on the capital market, I think. We actually cannot see the visible rise of telecom shares on the capital market. But even some for some telecommunication players, their share price is an all-time low. I think this also probably does not really reflect the reality of the business, but rather a pessimistic expectation on the market.
Right.
So
excellent.
Just
thank
a bit of summary.
Sure, no, that's excellent. Very, very much food for thought there. So in a way, you'd expect telecom to benefit enormously from the crisis. But the overall economic climate is presumably dampening some of the potential, right? I mean, that's one of the things you're saying. Excellent.
Yes.
Thank you very much. Maybe if you'll allow me, I would actually pivot straight. I'll come to you in a minute, Hassan, but just to follow up with the telecom and investment ideas, William, why don't we go straight to you on that? Just because there are a lot of connections. If that's all right with you, William.
Yeah, sure, of course.
He's just been saying.
Yeah, so I think what we've seen with COVID, and we focus again on what we call mobile first, mobile only. Previous years, used to sort of call it like emerging markets or developing markets. But these markets, because they're getting to the internet at a much earlier stage of their economic development, we like to call them mobile first or mobile only, where the only way people access the internet is over their smartphone. And so you get a leapfrog effect. And because of COVID, we've seen a massive acceleration in these markets from Pakistan to India to Indonesia, a massive acceleration in adoption of technology. You know, people don't want to be using cash. There's a lot more delivery. There's a lot more use of e-wallets and digital wallets, and a lot more use of things like Zoom and messaging. We're looking at a 2 to 3 year acceleration. So on the one hand, our portfolio in the travel space has been hit. Because we're focused on internet and software, we moved very quickly to take advantage of this. That's a struggle in and of itself because, you know, downturns hurt, but upturns are also a struggle because you have to manage the massive influx of demand. And I don't think anybody here has experienced what some of our companies are experiencing, which is 50 to 80% month-on-month growth 6 months in a row. Companies are going profitable, but they can't hire fast enough. The challenge comes where early stage startups can be a lot more nimble than traditional companies. But those traditional large enterprises and even governments need to learn how to be nimble. For example, I'm here in Shanghai. We got hit by COVID first. Didn't get to India and Indonesia until a month, month and a half, 2 months later. But since we had experience here where restaurants were shut down and traditional mom and pop supermarkets or markets or, you know, roadside stands are all shut down, we took our company that traditionally supplied restaurants and repurposed it to supply local markets. And we took our food delivery company that was traditionally serving restaurants to deliver home. That was all shut down. But delivering food from markets to people's homes was basically the only way people in lockdown were getting food. So even if you have a lockdown, you still have to eat. And because of that, that is that a pivot? Well, pivot usually implies that you messed up in some way. But in this case, it was an external. And the idea here is to quickly change because the challenges or the problems or the opportunities that existed very rapidly changed. And you have to solve a problem that's here and now, not a problem that used to happen. So that's the approach we've taken. It's very data driven. And we encourage everyone to move faster and really analyze what the problems are of today and tomorrow, not the problems of pre-COVID.
Yeah, no, excellent, excellent, fascinating. I think the notion in a way that can almost be a, I mean, you'd think that everybody with increased investment and increased demand would be celebrating, but it brings its own challenges with it. But at any rate, we seem to have quite a lot of an online focus here. So clearly you are fundamentally the winners of this up to now. I mean, in very, very broad brush. Going to you, Hassan, in your region and your province and China, Pakistan, Afghanistan, do you find that you have had to change your investment strategy to go for a different type of company investing, or how has this affected you?
Well, you know, initially it started here in Pakistan. I mean, it started at our borders, perhaps March, and then the government realized we need to take some immediate steps. We shut down all our borders, especially with Iran and Afghanistan, because initially the pandemic flow was coming from to our eastern part. Having done that, you know, some of the trade flows in terms of agri-based products and some of the other consumer products that we produce here, especially in my province, you know, the supply chain were cut and, you know, there was disturbance in terms of, you know, the overall SME sector and some of the industries. But I was part of the task force which was assigned specific tasks to look at which industry to allow during the pandemic. So we immediately took some bold decisions and gave permission to agriculture, telemedicine perhaps, and you know, and pharmaceutical industry. So all in all, in the last about 6 months, we've seen that our pharmaceutical industry, our agri-based industry, you know, the real estate sector surprisingly has jumped back many fold actually.
The real estate.
It's the prices of land has gone up significantly in the last 2 months. Perhaps that's because the government has given special initiatives in construction sector. We have given some, you know, unprecedented. The National Bank has given products which are unprecedented. Mm-hmm. But all in all, I think lucky that the casualty rate remained significantly low if you compare it with global trend. And we were the most pleasing part for me sitting here, because I'm partially involved as an academician teaching in some university, was there was a surge in number of female entrepreneurs coming in telemedicine, you know, supply chain, even logistics. And if you know a little bit about Khyber Pakhtunkhwa and our western border, this would extremely be pleasing for you, because we have these cultural, you know, I won't say restriction, but a trend, and that is now changing. And I would request each one of you here to please look at Pakistan, because we are expecting relocation happening. We've just recently inaugurated one special economic zone in a PPP mode with China Roads and Bridges Corporation, which is a large infrastructure company, enterprise, SOE. So I think I would request you, and this is a fantastic initiative, a lot of great people, you know, I can see in my screen. So if we can join hands together and perhaps support each of our initiatives and perhaps bring in, for me, investment coming to Pakistan is extremely important, not just in terms of, you know, numbers, but also in terms of creating employment opportunities. Because overall, because of COVID-19, we're seeing that we really need some support in the IT sector. We need support in pharmaceutical industry, perhaps, you know, more taking the next leap. And perhaps also in agri-based industry, where we can actually increase our yield. One important point I realize, and I've written a lot about this, is that those countries which had strong agriculture base were able to do well overall in terms of making the supply chain run, and we were able to do that also. Our rural part of our country was not hit the way. Probably that's our trend also, because keep social distancing as part of our culture in rural areas. So that helped actually, and we see re-urbanization happening. Not at a big scale, but at least at a scale that we can, do some research on. So while there were a lot of challenges, there were some positives also.
Yes.
My request again is that let's join hand and bring investment to countries like Pakistan. We have some cash flows. We have the thrust.
Yeah.
We need all of you.
No, thanks a lot, Hassan. Very interesting points there. About the agricultural sector. Interesting, you, William, with your company investing in agri-tech. We must think about that. And pharmaceuticals and telemedicine, and several of you have mentioned, you also mentioned the telemedicine, obviously growing exponentially at the moment. And I thought your point about women was very interesting too, because of course, if there are some cultural barriers to certain activities in the workforce, if it's done remotely, those barriers no longer exist, do they? So that's rather a fascinating sort of byproduct of this. Morgan, can I come to you right now? And what do you think about whether you've had to pivot your business and again the overall effects of COVID?
Okay, I guess it's a requirement adapting to the market, especially. So the situation is that in Malta, let me talk about one of the businesses, the education business.
Education.
So primarily students in Malta would have always preferred to be taught face-to-face. So most students would have rather met with the tutor on campus rather than studying online. But COVID was obviously an opportunity for most business schools in Malta, because we were able to implement and adapt the technology which we already had available to us in pushing online tuition. I would say that the vast majority of our students have adapted well to online education, although the cohort which I was expecting to adapt best is the least able to adapt.
Which one?
Our programs are directed to the younger cohort, so people who left their higher secondary and are studying kind of their first degree, because most of our students are typically adults. But this particular cohort would rather continue face-to-face. So I would have thought, because they were born digital, they would have found it much easier to study online. But the lack of human contact with their peers on campus was having a dire effect. So mostly it would have affected mental health, I would presume, rather than the actual education. But we've seen a pushback on the younger cohort. And how this will affect us, this will become kind of the new normal, I presume, where it's an opportunity. I don't see us in the future, when things settle down, that we will stay completely online, but we'll definitely have the opportunity of running blended programs. So for us, education is more of a blended solution, where there is part of it pre-recorded, part of it is online delivery, and part of it is face-to-face education. So we're pivoting. It's a major pivot, but we're adapting to the scenario, that's for sure.
Yes, excellent. It's interesting, isn't it, that in a lot of stuff we've seen, we've been talking about accelerating trends that already exist, aren't we? So online education existed, and it got a big kick forward because of this. Okay. Telemedicine existed, it's got a big kick forward. Virtual meetings, I suppose, instead of actual meetings, again, they've got a kick in advance. Yeah. Torsten, actually, what do you think, maybe you could give us a little bit of an idea about whether, first of all, whether there are some rather unexpected directions that COVID has or impacts, whether it's just accelerating what was already happening. But whatever you feel like, Torsten.
I think it's both, actually. Right now, my understanding of the situation is that most of the companies that we see actually do not really have to talk or think about pivoting their business as is right now, right? We see, you know, if you want to win the recovery race, to put it that way, it's more important to become more efficient, to use the technologies and technology progress that is there, talking about telecommunications and digitization, stuff like that. But also, on the other hand, becoming more efficient when it comes to headcount and topics like that, improve the processes. You could say, you know, that's something you should always do, but given the current challenges, I would think that, you know, if we're talking about the 95% economy right now, that means, you know, on the recovery path, we would expect that 95% of the business as were before the pandemic actually gain traction again. That means they need to become much more efficient. That's, I think, more important in the short run, to become more efficient than to pivoting and kind of reconstructing your business model. Having said that, probably two ideas on what's going to happen going forward. I think one of the areas that hasn't been in the focus so far is the tremendous influence and the new role of the governments. You know, governments all over the world are expected to spend 10 trillion. That means 10,000 billion US dollars worth for kind of recovering activities. And that means governments will become much more important in the long, but also in the midterm perspective. And that, I think, is a tremendous challenge, but also a chance for a lot of companies to develop new businesses at the interface, not to the customers or to the other businesses, but also at the interface towards the governments. I think that's one of the trends that we see going forward. And the third one has been probably mentioned by some of the guys here in the talk already, but I would say it's in a broader sense that creating mutuality. We've seen that a lot of companies suffer already from, you know, the lack of cohesion among their employees. We see the same in societies. And I think all those business models are pretty much targeted at creating new mutuality, getting people the feeling of being connected, not only connected in technical sense, but in the kind of overall sense of understanding what my fellow employees, my fellow kind of people around me actually think. That's a huge new kind of market. We actually don't know how this market is going to evolve. It starts with home delivery, but it is much more than that. It's a kind of making up for the loss of direct personal contacts that we kind of experience. And I think that's a strategy that's going to kind of probably kind of lay way towards pivoting much more than digitization in itself.
That's a very interesting point, because in a lot of things we've talked about, take education, for example, and even sort of online delivery of food and all the rest. A lot of this is affecting the sense of community that people used to have. Of course, there are many advantages, and we'll come back to that. But the challenge is this: the lack of personal contact that we had pre-COVID, and the fact that we're happily moving in many, many areas towards more and more online interaction, does mean that we face these challenges. I'm sure all of you leading your companies or involved your companies have felt challenge of how do you create that sense of community, of motivation, of staff working together, and even of sparking ideas of each other. You know, the way that staff working together can somehow produce innovative ideas. And in education, as Morgan was saying, yes, some people are very happy about this, but I mean, inevitably, I mean, look what's happening with students at universities around the place. Some of them are kind of openly flouting the rules because they just want to get back together and meet each other again, because the educational experience, except for adults, has got a large part about social interaction, hasn't it? And certainly in college. I mean, we remember our college days, I guess, not so much if you can't go out and have a beer with all your student friends. So has anybody got any ideas here about what might be done, as Torsten sort of raised this challenge, to improve the sense of community, interaction amongst employees and students, etc., given the fact that we are working so much more online? Any thoughts on that?
Can I take the lead here?
Yes, sure, Hassan.
Okay, Before we, you know, I could answer to what you've highlighted, I would just like to, you know, state a fact about our tourism sector, because our province is largely a sizable share on in our GDP right. comes from tourism.
Yeah.
So, in term, and I'm stating this in terms of a strange phenomena, because, you know, for a country like Pakistan, you know, which was in the past, say, one decade, was hit by cross-border terrorism, which is now significantly improved. We've become a more resilient nation. So perhaps the impression, the fear and chaos that we saw around the world was not there in our country. It was not there, absolutely. Okay. Actually, it was challenged to actually tell people there is a problem and you should actually not show that kind of resilience that we really require.
Mm-hmm.
Most pleasing aspect I saw, again, that's primarily for urban centers, was the institution of family actually re-emerging. You know, like in our urban centers, we remain busy with our respective work. But when schools, when entertainment, when family was all back in one living room, we saw, as opposed to some of the countries in West, we saw families getting closer, which actually helped, you know, on online shopping, which helped in online dining, you know, some of the services, entertainment also came through online, and the family was enjoying and spending more money as one unit.
That's an interesting point. Yeah. No, thank you for that.
The other aspect I would just like to highlight is in developing countries, especially in India, Pakistan, perhaps in China also, we see this middle class growing. And they're willing to spend money, especially on entertainment and tourism. And this is more specific for a country like Pakistan. So that sector was hit bad, but since our opening, there's about 30% surge in entertainment and tourism, and this is largely driven by middle class. So while
thanks very much for that. So we got not so many minutes left. I really appreciate that. That's a very interesting point about the fact that in a counterintuitive way, this pandemic managed to. Sort of have positive effects on family life and people being spending time together. I think that's quite interesting. Although, you know, maybe it depends if you have a happy family life in the first place. But no, that's a very good point. There's a question coming in from the audience, but while I'm reading it, William, can I just ask you quickly here? You know, we've talked about a lot of sectors. We've talked about pharmaceuticals. We talked about agritech, and we talked about entertainment and tourism. Very interesting what Hassan said about tourism too. Without asking you to give away the secrets of your VC activities, William, could you give us a sense of what areas do you think, or what sectors will or are already benefiting most, and which are suffering most in terms of investment?
Sure. I think, travel has been hit quite hard. So, you know, that's a pretty easy one. Active in that space. What we're actually seeing a huge amount of, especially in what you guys would call developing our emerging markets, is digitization of traditionally offline business. Okay, so you're taking people who use pen and paper for mom and pop shops or small shops or small medium businesses, and you're bringing that online, and you're enabling those offline companies to come offline, to go online. To do business. We're not just seeing it with small companies or mom and pops. We're also seeing it with people, from consultants to artists to any type of knowledge worker. Before, they used to come in and provide a service. Now they're taking that service online and providing the tools for them to actually deliver what a lot of people call the future of work. You know, when people say that, what does that actually mean? Well, it means that you can do work without having to be physically in any one particular place. And so the technology that underpins that is key. And then the last thing is that retail, traditional retail has been disruptive, being disruptive. E-commerce, which we see in China, over 25% of all sales goes through online. But the rest of the world is going to see a mass acceleration, especially in the emerging developing markets, to e-commerce, especially because people just simply do not want to go out to the shops anymore. So this is not, you know, we're facing a situation in which large companies like Google, Facebook, Amazon, four or five large Chinese guys, Alibaba, Tencent, they're building virtual monopolies. And we're using technology to enable basically everybody else to stay in business and not lose out to these very, very large companies. And so we're investing heavily in digitizing, you know, just normal people.
Excellent. Very good point. Thank you for that. We've got a question about education. We've got a couple of questions coming in. I'm sure you've all read them. So let's just think a little bit about education for a minute. Really, this question of if we're all moving towards online education, I mean, what are the real challenges there in terms of the effectiveness of education? And then, of course, the fact that we don't build this community that we did before. I don't know, Morgan, we'll come to you in a second, but I wonder, Yi, in your business, you know, telecom, you are focusing very much on connectivity. But do you see any pluses or minuses about online education going forward?
This is a very good question, because usually what we see is the connectivity side. But for the online education, just probably happening, my wife is in the area. So I just get a bit. I think the key point I really mentioned is, of course, there's an increasing demand and extreme opportunity for the online education, not only for the students, but also, for example, for our company, just one of the social emotional aspect is also encouraging our teams to take more online education. But the challenge being there, I think connectivity cannot resolve is how to keep the personalized interaction between teacher and students and between the students.
Yes.
And my view is probably come back also to the earlier comment, like for the telecom operators, we need also to think about how to more leverage the known technology like AR and VR and to create a different experience. And of course, going forward, I think a bit mixed up online and offline. But I do still think this is probably one of the huge challenge, how to keep really still the personalized experience.
Right. Yeah, thanks, Yi. Morgan, that seems to be a very good comment from you. Would you have any last thoughts about, I don't know, the challenges of online education or what we might see in the future, more or less of it?
So if we plan to implement online education as we've implemented online education in the past, I think we're bound to repeat the same mistakes, because we cannot not try to integrate some kind of further interaction between both the tutors and the students, not only during but after the session. So we have to create the model, the previous model of simply pushing content which was in a class online is not enough.
Yeah.
I would say most students would agree or that part of the journey in a university was the interaction that they've had outside of classroom hours and what they've learned from peers, not only from the educators. So we need to create models that would at least mitigate these issues. So the hybrid model is slightly effective, but it gives the option of having people meet when that is possible. But online only, I would say it only feasible for a student who simply wants a degree. He's not the further integration, so to speak. So it's very limited. Most students the contact and the peer contact.
So paradoxically, for adult education, it's actually more positive, isn't it? Because they just want to get the, you know, get the degree, get the certificate, as it were, and move ahead, as opposed to the social side.
Yeah, to some extent, yes. Or maybe because when you're an adult, you can be more focused. You learn that you need to structure your time, and education is education. So if you need to be online, at least you have to be online and listen. But I would still think any adult would still wish to get the contact, not necessarily physical, but discussion based and so forth.
Yes, no, you're right. And even a network as well, even building a network.
Yeah,
right.
Would you mind if I like to chime in again, because I think that's a very important point here. I think we see in education that everything we do is not just about exchanging information. I think that can be done pretty well via new kind of digitized models and stuff like that. And I wouldn't kind of belittle the kind of enormous contributions of the IT and telecoms industry. But in the end, we right now see that is not, that alone is not enough. And I think we see this in education, but we also see this in when it comes to society. We see this in companies that lack cohesion and stuff like that. And I think that's one of the major challenges aside of technology when it comes to pivoting your business. How do we actually kind of do both and get, you know, this feeling of mutuality back again and revived in a society that for the time being at least is much more distant than it was in the past. Mm-hmm.
Thanks, everybody. I was going to ask a last question. I don't think we have time for that. But I would just sum up and by saying that there are new investment opportunities, aren't there, William and others, because we've faced the challenge. We see the opportunities. Most of you are doing very well out of this because a lot of you are facing working online. But at the same time, there are challenges and there are disadvantages of the online world. And there's investment opportunities for all of us to think about with innovation, looking ahead to try and combine the best of it with obviously the challenges that COVID has given to all of us. So thank you very much, everybody. I think we'll all be in contact at least with each other. And it's been a great pleasure meeting all of you.
Thank you, sir. And I invite you all to Pakistan.
Yes.
We will all come, actually.
We will come. Great.
Thank you very much. Thanks, guys. Okay.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Have a good rest of the day.
Bye-bye.
Take care.